A PDF of additional material accompanies this audiobook. Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Official Amazing Race Travel Companion, 20 Years of Roadblocks, Detours, and Real-Life Activities to Experience Around the Globe, by Elise Doganieri, with a foreword by Phil Kogan. Read by Andi, Arndt. I dedicate this book to my loving and supportive parents, Lorraine and Michael Doganieri. Thanks for inspiring me, encouraging me, and most of all, believing in me. I will forever miss your Amazing Race-themed dinner parties inspired by the culture, food, and traditions of each country we traveled to during the season. I miss you both every day. You are always with me. To move, to breathe, to fly, to float, to gain all while you give, to roam the roads of lands remote, to travel is to live. Hans Christian Andersen. Foreword. I recently found a Kodachrome slide of my great-uncle Morris carrying me across the tarmac to board an NAC Boeing 737 with my family. I was almost three. My parents had decided to leave New Zealand to take on a new adventure in Guelph, a small university town in Canada. At the time, I was blissfully unaware that my first trip to the other side of the world would lead to a lifetime of travel. Now, whenever I see a plane in the sky, I can't help but wonder where its lucky passengers are heading, and always wish I was with them. Over more than 50 years, I've had the privilege of visiting more than 130 countries, many of them dozens of times. I'm often asked where my favorite place is. New Zealand has to be up there. I love any opportunity to get home and be with my family. Italy also ranks highly, because it has all the ingredients I like for a good trip. Fantastic history, culture, wine, food, and people. The truth is, I really think my favorite place to visit is a place I've never visited before. I love planning adventures, researching where to go and what to do before packing my bags. Preparing for a trip allows you to extend the journey and maximize your time once you get there. I walked the old ghost road through the Southern Alps with my dad a few years back, and some of my fondest memories of the trip were of us poring over maps of the terrain we were going to face in the weeks leading up to our hike. If time isn't a factor, there's also something wonderful about having absolutely no clue what lies ahead of you. Jumping in headfirst offers a chance to venture into the unknown, get lost on purpose, and let randomness take over. Back in the late 1990s, I set out to meet the Yukuana people of Venezuela. After landing in Caracas, I jumped in a small plane and flew into the heart of the Venezuelan jungle. We touched down on a dirt runway, and I headed to the very end of a long, winding dirt road in a 4x4. At that point, I found myself off the map. This was where I met a local biologist named John, who had arranged for us to travel upriver in a dugout canoe. After a 4-hour trip, we were met by the Yukuana chief, who kindly invited us to stay with him and his family for a few days. I decided to completely let go of my agenda and allow myself to be fully immersed in the ways of the Yukuana people. The majority of our time was spent hunting and gathering, and while I'm not 100% sure about everything I ate during my stay, I now know that green ants in leaves mixed with spiderwebs taste like citrus, and grilled piranha is surprisingly delicious. I'm glad to say the 100-pound capybara we were hunting got away. While I'm up for just about anything, eating the world's largest rodent was not exactly something I felt I needed to add to my to-do list. Traveling extensively all through my childhood with my plant scientist father and music teacher mother, I was taught that wherever you go in the world, you're a guest, and just like visiting someone's house, it's important to be respectful of others' customs. If they would prefer you take your shoes off at the door, don't argue. Treat people with respect, and you're almost guaranteed to be treated the same way. If you're being hosted, let that person take the lead. Step back a bit and take in what's going on around you. Pay careful attention to the way people dress. If you're in doubt about what to wear, ask. Make an attempt at the local language and customs. Try to blend in and fly under the radar. Ask yourself, Am I being too loud or pulling out my camera at the wrong time? While it's impossible to get everything right, always try your best not to be offensive in any way. My mind is filled with incredible memories of the places and adventures I've been fortunate enough to enjoy. Mining in Cooperpedi, Australia, the opal capital of the world. Diving with hundreds of whale sharks off the coast of Mexico. Getting my reindeer racing license in Finland's Arctic Circle. Having a 5-star meal on top of the Mount Stromboli volcano during an eruption. Putting a golf ball from coast to coast across Scotland and ending on the 18th green at St. Andrews. Breaking an unofficial bungee jumping world record with 8 other crazies in Queenstown, New Zealand. Exploring the world's longest underwater caves below the jungle on the Yucatan Peninsula. Riding my bike across America and later circumnavigating France on an 85-year-old Tour de France bicycle. Hundreds of adventures, millions of miles, dozens of trips around the world, and ultimately what I remember most are the people I've met along the way. If I can give you any advice about travel, it's that you should make an effort to meet the locals. Don't lock yourself away in a hotel. Find out where the best eating spots or food trucks are, and the best places to get coffee or fresh fruit, or even where the favorite watering holes are. You will be blown away by the kindness of strangers, and you never know, you may make enduring friendships along the way. Another great way to connect with people is to reach out to those who share your interests. My family met lifelong friends when a couple reached out to my mother to play music. For years, they would travel the world and connect with local musicians to play classical pieces. While they weren't always able to speak the same verbal language, they were able to share the international language of music. The more I travel, the more I realize I still have so much to learn. Your passport can literally open up a world of surprises. Don't be scared to get out there and explore. You'll quickly realize that people all over this planet are searching for the same things: better lives for themselves and their children, and connection with other humans. You never know. That might mean you. When I set out on my first amazing race adventure, I wanted to say something that would capture the promise of what was to come. And that was when I first uttered the line, "The world is waiting for you." It was then, and it is now. Live while you still have a chance. Swerve off that predictable road you've been following for years to connect with people you don't know, beginning with yourself. Go on, get out there and take it before you kick it. Phil Kogan. Introduction. We are so thrilled to share with you some of the incredible places we have traveled to on the Amazing Race so that you might use this book as a guide to plan out your next big adventure, or use it as a launching point if you already have a trip planned and need some inspiration. We have certainly traveled far and wide and chosen some of our most epic locations, which you will now be able to check out here in this book. But it's only fair to give you a little background on how it all began. I was born in New York and had a very happy childhood with my loving parents, Lorraine and Michael, and my sister, Renee. In 1986, I attended the Fashion Institute of Technology to study advertising and graphic design, and soon after graduating in 1990, I started a consulting and design firm. My husband, Bertram, who was born in the Netherlands, went to the University of Munich to study filmmaking and traveled the world directing and producing commercials and documentaries. In March of 1995, we met by chance on Franklin Street in NYC. My design firm was on the ground floor of a Tribeca loft, and I used the walls to display local artists' work. Bertram, who was living in Los Angeles at the time, was filming a pilot for a new television series with a mutual friend of ours, and they needed a large painting for one of their scenes. Our friend told Bertram that I had several that might work. I met Bertram at my studio to negotiate a rental price for the painting, but funnily enough, we could not agree on a number. But he did ask me to dinner, and that was the beginning of our relationship. 2 years later, I sold my company and moved to Los Angeles to start fresh with Bertram. At the time, Bertram had sold a wildlife series to Paramount called Wild Things, and we worked together on the pilot. We traveled to Alaska and Kenya for a few months, and I enjoyed every minute of it. But I was offered a job at a big advertising agency that I couldn't pass up. Wild Things went on to be successful, and I missed those days of traveling terribly. In the fall of 1999, Bertram went to a trade show, but nothing awed him. When he returned, I said, "I don't know why there's nothing new and exciting in television." He laughed and said, "You think it's so easy? Why don't you come up with an idea? I'll give you 5 minutes." I said, "Okay," and in that very moment, I thought of the backpacking trip through Europe I had taken with my college roommate. I had a very vivid memory of the crazy adventures we had been on that summer, traveling from NYC to Madrid, taking an overnight ferry to Ibiza, traveling on a Eurail pass throughout Europe, staying in hostels, trying to communicate without speaking the language, and doing it all with a backpack and very little money. Midway through the trip, we found ourselves in Rome, and I was eager to get up early and get going. We had made plans to get together with some friends we'd met on the train, but Lori, who was super easygoing, had had it with my go-go-go attitude. I will never forget her saying, "This isn't Chevy Chase's European vacation. Why don't you do your own thing today, and I'll do mine?" So we took a break from each other that day and met in the evening for dinner, and all was good again. But the flashback to that moment sparked an idea. A global travel adventure competition, where teams of two would race around the world competing in mental and physical challenges. With very little money, and most likely not speaking the native language, they would travel from country to country by plane, bus, boat, train, car, or taxi, immersing themselves in the culture by doing things the locals do. Sometimes teams would do tasks together, and sometimes they would do them separately. But taking on a nonstop, nearly month-long competition together like this would definitely test their relationship. Bertram had traveled the world and worked in just about every country an airplane, train, boat, or bus could get to, so I knew he could make this show a reality. For years, he had developed relationships in countries around the world, and he has a special way of making the impossible possible, even in the most remote locations. With his global network of contacts, he had already built the infrastructure necessary for the amazing race. And that's the way we brought this show to life. Bertram sat there for a moment after hearing the idea and then said, "I love it. Write it up and we'll pitch it." Our agent at CAA suggested we meet with Bruckheimer television executive Jonathan Littman, and we soon decided to work together. We pitched the show to CBS, ABC, NBC, and Fox. All the networks liked it, but CBS saw it as a franchise and a long-running series, so that is ultimately where we landed. With CBS greenlighting the show, I had to make a decision. Should I quit my job at the advertising agency to pursue this full-time? Bertram knew how unpredictable television could be. It was possible that the show would never air or only run one season, and recommended that I not quit my job. I spoke with my boss, and they allowed me to take a leave of absence. I would return after we were done filming. Within a few months, Bertram and I had set up our production company, World Race Productions, and hired a full staff. With a small team of seasoned producers, we headed out scouting locations. Everything happened so fast. I remember flying to Delhi, India, taking a train to Agra, and then there I was, standing in front of the Taj Mahal. It was surreal. In just a few months, so much had changed, and I couldn't have been more excited. We started filming in early 2001. We had our cast, which was about to take on an adventure like no other, and they had no idea what to expect. And honestly, neither did we. I remember standing at the Bethesda Fountain in New York City when the bus pulled up with all of the teams, everyone filled with adrenaline and anticipation. The teams lined up in front of Phil, and he said the words, "The world is waiting for you. Go!" And they were off in all directions with our incredible camera crews running alongside them. In that moment, we all realized that we had better get going because the teams were all ahead of us. That's pretty much how it goes. We, as the producers, are in our own race to stay ahead of the nonstop freight train of contestants. We have dealt with delayed or canceled flights, missed trains and slow buses, sandstorms, typhoons, snowstorms, broken down vehicles, burned out clutches, flat tires, and running out of gas. We have seen and experienced it all and loved every minute of it. The show premiered on September 5th, 2001, and 33 seasons later, we couldn't be more excited to have had more than 20 years and counting on the air. Season after season, Bertram and I never lose the thrill of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.